I know in some people's minds, you know, and you probably hear this too, I hear people raise the objection, well, you know, the Bible, the Gospels, I mean, they were written, you know, decades, hundreds of years, I've heard people say, after the events. How can we be sure we're dealing with eyewitness testimony and not stuff that's just been made up? What convinces you that we've even got that category of eyewitness testimony there in the Gospels in the first place? Help us with that one.
Yeah, well, a lot of this is cumulative, right? So when I make a case in front of a jury, I don't rely on one piece of evidence. I rely on a number of pieces of evidence that point to the same reasonable inference. And so for me, it is a cumulative case of these four areas of concern. But the first one is, if they're not written early enough, if you want to lie about Jesus, here's how you do it. You wait till everyone who knows the truth is dead. Okay, this is one of the problems we have in criminal cases too. So this is the problem, I think, for the Gospels. Are they written early enough, number one, to have been written in the time span in which eyewitnesses would still be available to write them? And also written early enough to be written in the time span in which people who would know better could call them out as lies. And that's why I needed to know how early the Gospels were written. I think you can make a cumulative, circumstantial case for the early dating of the Gospels in terms of what's missing from the New Testament. So we know from the New Testament, for example, that there is no description in the book of Acts by Luke, the author of Acts, no description of the destruction of the temple in 70 AD. Now, what I think that's interesting that it's missing, and so is the siege from a couple of years earlier, the siege of Jerusalem. It's interesting that that's missing because Paul, I mean, Luke's going to talk about how Jesus predicts the destruction of the temple. There's an entire, the Gospels, almost all the Gospels, yeah, all of them have some statement about this impending doom that's coming. Right? I just read into the Gospel of Mark last night with my wife. We read through the Bible together, and I think we're in chapter 12, and you'll see the descriptions of it there as well. Well, wouldn't you want to include the actual destruction of the thing that Jesus predicted if you're trying to prove that he's an accurate predictor? It's missing, though. It's not in. If you're writing a history of New York City around the 2000s and you left out the Twin Tower attack, I'd want to know why you left it out. And that siege and destruction of Jerusalem was every bit as bad in that century to those people as the Twin Tower attack was. But it's missing from Luke's book of Acts. So is the fact that we know when Peter and Paul and James, the brother of John of Jesus, rather, died, but Paul's still alive at the end of the book of Acts. There's no description of the death of Peter, no description of the death of James, the brother of Jesus. Yet, Luke does describe other deaths. He describes the death of James, the brother of John. For what reason do I need to know that? He's not even a somebody, if you think about it. James, the brother of Jesus, is a somebody. So why would I be listing some but not others? Well, it's reasonable to me, it seems, at least we could test this hypothesis, that if it hasn't happened yet, there's a good reason why you might not describe it yet. And the earliest death missing is James in 61. So let's just say we're in 60-ish, is the writing of the book of Acts. Well, we know he writes two books. The other book he writes is the Gospel of Luke. He writes that earlier. So how much earlier is it than 60? Keep in mind that already we are within the lifetime of eyewitnesses. And you might think, well, but there's even more internal evidence within the scripture. I think you see in several places where Luke is actually referenced as scripture, the Gospel of Luke, by Paul. He talks about Luke's gospel as scripture in a letter to Timothy, for example, when he mentions a verse from Luke's gospel and compares it to Deuteronomy as quote-unquote scripture. He also talks to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians, and he mentions the only version of the Lord's Supper, in which Jesus says to do these things in remembrance of me. He only says that in one place. That's in the Gospel of Luke. Then he's writing that in the early 50s to the Corinthian church. There are good reasons to believe that Luke's gospel is available to Paul early, and that's why it's missing some of the data in the book of Acts, as I previously described. And I think that's one of the reasons why I think that the gospels are written early. But even if you said, well, look, 20 years is too late, because there's no way I can get that information orally over 20 years without distortion. Well, you and I both know as speakers that if we get called out to ask to do certain talks, and I do the same, like 50 talks in different locations all over the country all the time. And if you were to get the transcript of any one of my talks, I don't care if I gave it the first week or now 10 years later, you will see the transcripts are pretty much word for word the same. Even the pauses I take and how I deliver the lines are for the most part the same. My daughter noticed this when she was working the book table behind my, in my room. She'd say, I now know all of your talks by heart. And to be honest, I could do a better job presenting them because I am a funnier person. And so I recognize that, yes, if I'm out and immediately telling people about what I saw over and that form of evangelism, the personal eyewitness observation, you see this in the book of Acts. If I'm doing that consistently for any period of time, I have great confidence that we can get that information to the end before it's ever penned. And the question then becomes really, well, why aren't these written earlier? Why would you wait at all? And I think there's good reason to look at those scriptures and say to yourself, hey, these folks, I think, believed that Jesus was going to come back in their lifetime. You see this all the way through the writings, that there's a sense in which, hey, we have a sense of urgency because Jesus is coming. Until, of course, we start to see our co-workers being murdered, like James, the brother of John, in 44. And I think it's then that you start to see, hey, you know what? We're not necessarily going to get out of this alive. We better start writing this stuff down. And that's when you start to see the appearance of the early gospels.